أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والحمد لله الذي جعلنا من المتمسكين بولاية أمير المؤمنين والأئمة المعصومين عليهم السلام، والحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله، والحمد لله الذي لا يبلغ مدحته القائلون ولا يحصي نعماه العادون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتهدون، الذي لا يدركه بعد الهمم ولا يناله غوص الفطن، الذي ليس لصفته حد محدود ولا نعت موجود ولا وقت معدود ولا أجل ممدود، فطر الخلائق بقدرته ونشر الرياح برحمته ووتد بالصخور ميدان أرضه، ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، خاتم النبيين، شفيع المذنبين، حبيب إله العالمين، أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين، ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من يوم عداوتهم إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فقد قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الحكيم وهو أصدق القائلين، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، ولكل أمة أجل فإذا جاء أجلهم لا يستأخرون ساعة ولا يستقدمون. آمنا بالله، صدق الله العلي العظيم. صل على محمد وآل محمد. أما بعد، السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. I begin in the name of Allah تبارك وتعالى. There is no doubt that it's due to His kindness and generosity that He provides for us opportunities such as these where we gather in remembrance and in glorification of Him تبارك وتعالى. Next, we begin this sermon the way the commander of the faithful, Ali ibn Abi Talib, alayhima afzalu salatu wassalam. We'll begin many of his sermons by saying, Usikum wa nafsi bi taqwallahi al-azim. I advise you and I advise myself to be God-conscious, God-fearing, and pious human beings. We have been discussing the subject of Quranic eschatology, the subject of death and life after death as it is discussed in the Holy Quran. And last week we finished the discussion regarding the landscape of Barzakh, the different geographical boundaries that we will find in Barzakh. And today we proceed with our discussion by discussing the social order that we will see in Barzakh. Now, when we talk about the social order, what exactly are we referring to? Here are ulama, when they discuss the social order, they are talking about a system of leadership and rule. Is there going to be a leader in Barzakh? Is there going to be someone who leads and guides and rules over the inhabitants of Barzakh? You know, when we talk about social order, it is a rule that in every society and in every grouping of individuals or beings, there has to be a social order. There has to be. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala discusses this in the Holy Quran when He talks about the hierarchy that exists amongst the angels as well. That even in their organization, even in their system, there has to be a hierarchy of order. And this hierarchy of order starts, and the command belongs to Angel Jibreel alayhi salam. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran, in Surah number 81, verses 19 through 21, he discusses, إِنَّهُ لَقَوْلٌ رَسُولٍ كَرِيمٌ. Most surely it is the word of an honored messenger. Here they are referring to specifically to Angel Jibreel, ذِي قُوَّةٍ إِنَّ ذِي الْعَرْشِ الْأَحْسَنْتُ مَكِينٌ. The possessor of strength and having an honorable place with the Lord of the Dominion. يعني he's having a maqam that is high with the Lord. And then furthermore, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, muta'in thumma Ameen, ahsantum. That he is obeyed. Yeah, that angel Jibreel is obeyed and they put their trust in him. Yani he is faithful in his trust. So even in the order of angels, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala discusses a hierarchy. And when we see the system, we see it clearly in the world that we live in today. That there is a hierarchy, there is a system of governance, leadership that exists within our society. However, in our society, the system of governorship or leadership exists through military prowess. Yeah, some exist, for example, when someone has a might with the military, they take a coup and they lead a country, for example. Other systems exist through hereditary transfer. For example, the father had the power, now the son takes the power. And you see that many countries in the world that we live in have that type of system. Other systems are in place where you see that, for example, the majority elect somebody. These are different examples that we see in the world that we live in today, the system that is in place today. What is interesting is that in the land of the evildoers that we talked about last week, we see a similar system that we have in dunya exist in that realm, where the ones who are strong will occupy and have power over those who are weak. And furthermore, not only that, those who are weak will align themselves with those who are strong for their own safety. So it's very similar to the system that we see in the world that we live in today. However, that's the land of the evildoers, that in their social order, they will try to survive based on their own interests and their own needs. But when we look at the land of the virtuous, and in particular the land of the muqarrabun, those who have the highest station in barzakh, and so too will have the highest station in akhirah, when we look at their land, you find that in their land, the system or the hierarchy or the rulership that is in place is based on love. Yeah? It is based on love. Now, this is very interesting, right? And how is it based on love? In that land, the land of the muqarrabun, those who have the highest capacity to receive the most of divine grace, yeah, those who are closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will automatically be obeyed by everyone else in that land. Yeah? Because they will recognize, yeah, they only attained or earned a spot in that land because of their closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because they worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through love. And therefore, when they see in that land, there is no doubt that there is going to be people who loved God better than they loved Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there will be no jealousy. They will automatically obey these people who are closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the most beautiful form of leadership there is. Yeah? The way we submit to the wilayat of Muhammad and Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Is based on a similar structure. Yeah, we obey them, we follow them, we love them. Why? Because we recognize that they are closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah? For no other reason. Yeah? We don't obey them because they are from the family of... No, we obey them because we recognize their position with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the same manifestation will take place in the realm of barzakh. It's very interesting then, right? Because if you look at both of these different groups of people, those who are in the land of the evildoers, they live their life full of evil. They live their life full of corruption and greed. And therefore you see a similar manifestation of that in the social order of their being in barzakh. Likewise, for those who attain the muqarrabun, the position of the muqarrabun, it is because they were closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this land. And the manifestation is very similar in the land of barzakh. We are told by our ulama as well that there will be a slight variation in the social system when it comes to the land of the righteous. Now if you remember, in the land of the virtuous, it is divided into two groups of people. There is the muqarrabun and then there is the righteous. The muqarrabun are of a higher status, but the righteous have succeeded as well. They have entered the Jannah of barzakh. In the land of the righteous, the social system and the social order is based on a hierarchy of authority. What that means is, the more one is given authority, the more one is placed in a place of rulership or leadership. Now, how is this authority given? Here we are told that this authority is given based on knowledge and virtue. Yeah? The more knowledge one has, the more virtue one has, the higher their maqam in that land. There's a very interesting hadith that comes from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Li'ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. When he describes the levels or the status of people in Jannah. Now, why do we use this hadith to describe the land of Barzakh? You know, we are told that everything that happens in Barzakh is a more dulled version of what will happen in Akhirah. Yeah? So for example, if someone is receiving the benefits of Jannah in Barzakh, and they will be enjoying themselves to that extent that we cannot even describe, when they go to Barzakh, it will be infinite times more pleasurous. Right? Same thing applies for the hell of Barzakh. That if one is feeling the azab of Barzakh, when they go into Akhirah, yeah, the azab will be infinite times worse. This is why the people of Barzakh will always say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what? La taqim as-sa'a, la taqim as-sa'a. Do not bring about the day of judgment, O Allah. Do not bring about the day of judgment. So when the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him and his family, describes the status or the levels of Akhirah, we can then extrapolate that and use that as an understanding of how it will be in Barzakh. He says in a tradition, Hamalatul Quran urafa'u ahlil jannah wal mujtahiduna quwadu ahlil jannah wal rusulu sadatu ahlil jannah. He says those who possess the knowledge of the Quran shall be the leaders or administrators of paradise. Yani they will be the one who will be giving out rules. They will be the ones who will be obeyed. And those who strived in God's path shall be the governors in Barzakh. So the leader must have governors in different areas. Those who strived hard but maybe could not master the same amount of knowledge as those before them, they will be then governors in Barzakh, and the prophets will be the leaders in paradise. Right? If you think about that, then the prophets will be those in the muqarrabun who are closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, while those who have the knowledge of the Quran, yeah, while those who lived their life according to the guidelines of the Quran, they will be the administrators and the rulers of Barzakh. There are many traditions like this, right, that say that the levels of Barzakh, for example, are equal to the number of ayat in the Holy Quran. Yes? The more one memorizes, they will be told, rise, recite and rise, recite and rise, recite and rise. Now, of course, we have to realize this, right? That this doesn't mean that this is the memorization of the Quran the way the parrots memorize the Quran. Yeah? The way those who are beautiful qaris have memorized the Quran, yet when you look at their lives, there is nothing about the Quran in their lives. Yeah? It is about one who lives the life of the Holy Quran. Yeah? It's about one who understands what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from them, and they live this life. When we understand these different social systems in Barzakh, what will happen is that there will be no contention in Barzakh. You know, here we don't like a leader, we vote for another leader in 4 years. Yeah? In other countries where there is dictatorships, we don't like the leader, there is a coup and that leader is overthrown. In Barzakh, there is nothing like that. Yeah? Because the people who will receive the positions in Barzakh are based on merit. Yeah? They have earned these positions. And the Ahlul Barzakh, Ahlul Jannatul Barzakh, will realize that position and they will follow them with full submission. Inshallah, next week we go a little bit further into the social system in Barzakh and discuss what will happen to the children who die in early life in this world, what will be their station in Barzakh, inshallah. Wa akhiru da'wan alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد صدق الله العلي العظيم. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والحمد لله قاسم الجبارين، مبير الظالمين، مدرك الهاربين، نكال الظالمين، صريخ المستصرخين، موضع حاجات الطالبين، معتمد المؤمنين. اللهم صل على خاتم النبيين وسيد المرسلين محمد. صل على محمد وآل محمد، وصل على سيد الوصيين أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب. صل على محمد وآل محمد، وصل على صديقة الطاهرة فاطمة الزهراء سيدتي نساء العالمين. صل على محمد وآل محمد، وصل على سبتي الرحمة وإمامي الهدى الحسن والحسين سيدي شباب أهل الجنة. محمد وآل محمد، وصل على علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والحجة القائم المهدي. صل على محمد وآل محمد صلاة لا غاية لعددها ولا نهاية لمددها ولا نفاد لأمدها. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات، وتابع بيننا وبينهم بالخيرات، إنك مجيب الدعوات، إنك على كل شيء قدير. ما صل على محمد وآل محمد.
We went to sleep last night with another very tragic event that happened in France, in Nice, during a celebration that were happening in France, where according to the last count that I saw, 85 people were killed, over 200 were injured when an individual ran his truck into a gathering of people who had gathered to celebrate, I believe it is Independence Day or one of the holidays, Bastille Day, in Paris, in France, in the city of Nice. I'm sure many of us who heard about this event held our breath to pray that, Ya Allah, please don't let this be a Muslim. Please don't let this be another terrorist act. Because, you know, we are feeling the repercussions of these actions in our lives. We as individuals, maybe not directly, but we know that our brothers and sisters are facing a tremendous amount of blowback from these events that are happening and transpiring throughout the world. When I read last night, right-wing news agencies like Fox had already associated this as an attack of Daesh. However, today when we read more articles, it was, they say, a Tunisian driver. Of course, his name was representing the name of our Prophet, very unfortunately. And but so far, they say they haven't found any type of links to any terrorist organization. But you know, if they want, they will find, and the people will believe. You know, we really have to take proactive steps, my brothers and sisters. Yes, we have to take proactive steps to counter Islamophobia. Just because we are not feeling any pressure at this moment, just because we may not be feeling any type of blowback, it doesn't mean that it won't reach our shores or it will not reach our houses. During the sermon of Eid, I had given results of a survey that were conducted, and I want to piggyback off that for a second. For those who didn't hear it, you know, the survey that was taken in Ontario, it says that only a third of Ontarians have a positive impression of the religion of Islam. Yeah, only a third. That means two-thirds of our neighbors have a negative image of the religion of Islam. Yeah, this is something that each and every one of us should be concerned about. Right? Because this is our home, this is where we live, this is where we expect our children to grow up and live a life of comfort and ease, as opposed to our brothers and sisters in different parts of the world. Furthermore, they say that more than half of Ontarians believe that the mainstream, the most important doctrines of Islam promote violence. Yeah? Think about that. Half of them think that our main doctrines, yeah, yani the guiding principles of our religion promote violence. You know, my brothers and sisters, we have failed Islam. Yeah? We have lived in this community now since the 60s, yeah, many of us. Many have now immigrated in the 2000s. But we haven't had a positive impact in the wider community for them to realize the truth about Islam, right? And this is something that all of us should take very personally, that we are reaping the benefits of God's bounties, but yet we are not giving anything back to the wider community. We need the support of the wider community for us to survive and live a comfortable life here. Yeah? We see what has happened in America, where there was this drive to promote, but yet when they didn't, because of the larger scope of the population of America, it's more difficult, no doubt, to target more people and to change their opinions. But we see the kind of opinions that people are coming out with. Just today, I believe it was Newt Gingrich, the former senator, came out with a statement that said that we need to question each and every Muslim in America and ask them of their allegiance to the United States. And if they don't have it, they must be deported. I mean, these are the kind of rhetorics that are coming out from right-wing extremists. And if we're not careful, we will expect the same type of actions here in Canada. And so there's a responsibility. There is. That all of us have to promote the image of Islam. And today I just have a couple of talking points, right? A couple of talking points to arm ourselves or to carry with ourselves facts. You know, when people accuse us of Islamophobia, or they don't even have to accuse us of that, we can bring out conversations. Yeah? When you go back to work, say, hey, did you see what happened in Paris or in Nice? It's terrible. Yeah? And when they say something about Muslims, remind them that Muslims died in this tragedy in France. Yeah? So it wasn't just non-Muslims who were killed in this tragedy. Even Muslims were killed in this tragedy. But you have to have more information. And today I just want to give a couple of things, you know. Here's some facts that you can use when you talk to people. In the United States, of all the domestic terrorist acts that have happened, right, 56% of them have been done by right-wing extremists in America. 56%. We're talking about the neo-Nazis, the KKK, and all of these right-wing Jewish Defense League, all of these different groups who are considered to be local terrorist organizations. 56% of them have been done by them, while another 30% have been done by eco-terrorists. And only 12% of terrorist actions in America have been done by those who claim the religion of Islam. Yeah? That means 88% of terrorist actions in America have been done by non-Muslims. Tell them that. Yeah? They don't realize that because the media will only highlight and call something a terrorist event when a Muslim does that event. Yeah? But that's not the reality, right? Furthermore, the FBI has reported that roughly two-thirds of terrorism in the United States was conducted by non-Islamic extremists from 1980 to 2001. And between 2002 and 2005, 95% of terrorist actions were done by non-Muslims. Yeah? Think about that. After 9/11, right? 95% of terrorist actions in a span of 5 years were done by non-Muslims. You add that into the full span of till 2015, 88% of them have been done by non-Muslims. In Europe, there have been 1,000 terrorist attacks over the past 5 years. In Europe, only 2% of those have been done by those who claim the religion of Islam. Yeah? That means 98% of terrorist actions have been done by non-Muslims. Right? They don't know these things. Many of us don't know these things. Right? But how are we going to defend the religion of Islam if we don't have facts? Right? If we don't have things for them to say, oh, really? I didn't know about that. Let me go check that out. Google it. You will find it, right? We have to take these steps, my brothers and sisters. Otherwise, we're walking in very dangerous times and dangerous areas. Furthermore, yeah, 82 to 97%. Yeah, there's a wide range because maybe there's unknown here. But 82 to 97% of victims of terrorism have been Muslims. Yeah, remind them of that. Yeah, nearly 90%. If we take the mean of that, 82 to 97, you take the mean of that, it's 90%. Yeah, 90% of victims of terrorist actions have been Muslims. I guarantee you, they don't know that. Yeah, I guarantee you they don't realize that. And these are the kind of information that we have to strike up conversation. We have to strike up dialogue. Make them see the hypocrisy that when a white man, American, runs into churches and kills black people in the churches, they never talk about the race of that individual. Yeah, they never talk about the religion of that individual. But when it's a Muslim, right away the religion comes up. Right away, the ethnicity comes up. These are the points, my brothers and sisters, that I urge myself and I urge you, we have to take proactive steps. Yeah, we have to take necessary actions to go forward and to make sure that this idea that Canadians have or Ontarians have about Islam, that they are not publicizing yet. They're not openly coming out and saying, but they feel it in their hearts. It's our job now to make sure that we change that feelings that they have. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the strength and the tawfiq to do so, insha'Allah. Wa akhiru da'wan. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Wal asr innal insana lafi khusr. إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر صدق الله العلي العظيم.